for splitting and engineering the features, but we will rather learn these features from data. So why does deep learning matter? Well, basically because it gives you results, good results. Before deep learning in tasks such as the ImageNet, large-scale visual correlation challenge, which is an international challenge for object classification, detection, and also segmentation, results were very scarce. Actually, as you can see here, before 2012 is when AlexNet came about. Before 2012, the top 5 error rate in this test, in the object classification test, was over 25%. With AlexNet, it's dropped down to 16.4, and nowadays we have something of around 3%. That means that in a test where I have 100,000 images to train, training a network, convolutional neural network, for correctly to classify these images, at the end I have only 3.08% of error. Now, with great accuracy comes also great training times, and that's a problem that you can find every single article that describes one of the ImageNet winners. You can see that the first one, the AlexNet, it took 25-6 days with two consumer-grade GPUs to train their models. And the latest one in the past few previous years, the Google Net, they actually trained it using CPUs, but they supposed that it could be trained using GPU high and GPUs within about a week. So here we see a problem, because it's true that low-level features and engineer features like saved and served gave poorer results, but they were already there. And here we actually have to take some weeks to train a classifier. So this makes it a little bit evident the need for faster methods, for speeding up this training of convolutional neural networks. So let's just recap the general structure of a convolutional neural network. So a CNN is basically made of two parts. We can see the first part, which is the repetition of a convolutional layer, a rectifying unit, and a max pooling. So usually when you see the modern architecture of a convolutional neural network, you will see these three blocks repeating themselves many times. This will basically define the depth of the network. And at the end, you will have some fully connected layers. So, of course, at the heart of a convolutional neural network is the convolutional layer. And this basically works like this. You have an input of feature maps. The first feature map, let's say, set of feature maps is the image itself. It's usually an RGB image, so we are talking about here about three channels, RGB. And the layers, they contain kernels, convolutional kernels. And for each kernel, we will produce one feature map. So for example, here we had an input which had three channels, and we convolve this input with the first kernel and produce the first output. We convolve it with the second one, produce the second output, the third one, and produce the third output, the fourth, and so on. So basically, the number of outputs, channels, is the number of kernels we have in the layer. And we can also see that since we're performing 2D convolutions, we need to have for each kernel the same number of channels as the input feature. And here comes our idea on how to speed up convolutional neural networks. I have to just give a small disclosure here that the use of rectifying linear unit is fairly new. Some of you who have probably studied neural networks many years ago will probably remember sigmoid functions for activation function for non-linearity. The good thing about rectifying the unit is that it speaks wisely. So we can exploit one good property of convolutional neural network, and that is the spatial scaling space, spatial scale of convolution. So basically, what the spatial scaling property of convolution tells me is that I can get the same result convolving two signals, the result y, by convolving two spatial scale signals, and then just rescaling it spatially and also in amplitude. So basically what I'm saying here is that I can get the output y, the first one, from the second one, the one below. And it's not very clear now, but this actually means that I can do convolution using smaller images and smaller kernels and get the same result as using bigger images and bigger kernels. Of course, that's not entirely true because we know that higher frequencies will not be acquired using this method. However, the idea is, well, can't I just start training my networks with these small kernels and small images? And it turns out that it can be. We can do this. So the idea here is that we start training with smaller images and also with smaller kernels in this pre-trained network. Then we will upscale the kernels to the final, to the regional, to the target network that we want to train. And also we will use the regional images that we have for the target network and continue training. So before we do this, it's nice to check if with some preliminary example tests, if this can actually work. So our test page, let's put it this way, is the Overfit network, which I believe won the 2013 detection challenge for ImageNet. So basically, the idea is if I get the Overfit, the fast version of Overfit, which is an 8-layer neural network, convolution neural network. And then here you can see that we have the target network, which is the original network, having for the first layer 11 by 11 convolutional resolution. The second layer, which is a 5x5, uses 5x5 kernels. The third one, that is 3x3, the fourth one, 3x3, and the fifth one. And then we have some fully connected layers. So the first step, we downsize these kernels. So the 11x11 becomes a 7x7. The second layer, which uses the 5x5, now uses a 3x3. And all the ones that use the 3x3, now use a 2x2. So, and we also have to downscale the input images. So originally, we use the 231x231 image, and now we're using 147x147. You can see that the ratio between each input and each modified kernel size is more or less the same. So, if you're familiar with training convolutional neural networks, you know that every time we show the entire data set to during training to a network, that is what is called an ad hoc. So every time you finish and you show the entire data set to the network, you say, well, I completed one ad hoc, and then I completed two ad hocs, and so on. And usually what you do is you train the network for an ad hoc, and then you validate, you test your network on a validation data set. This is the reason for that is to see one, how your network is really learning, if it's still learning, and also to compare the accuracy you're getting in the validation set with the accuracy you're getting in your test set to see if you're not overfitting. So basically what we have here is the graphs for the accuracy for both validation and training for the two neural networks. So basically what I want to show you here is that for the first 10 networks, meaning for the more or less for the same number of samples shown to the network, we have accuracy that all the two networks show for both training and validation, that they show the same accuracy. You can see here that they're about the same. So this means that the information that the network is learning can be generalized. And the idea is, since it can be generalized, can I just use the same information? Can I just transfer this information from the smaller one to the bigger one? And the answer seems to be yes, I can. This here, however, is the graph of the same graph that in the x-axis, we actually see not the number of networks, but the number of training hours. The idea of this graph and this image is to show you how we can, in theory, gain in terms of training time. So basically, you can see that the blue line and the dotted orange line, they are they refer to the network, the smaller network. So basically, for the same amount of hour of training hours, at the beginning we actually have higher accuracy on the smaller network. This is because it's faster. The convolution between the smaller kernels and the smaller inputs are faster than convolutions between bigger inputs and bigger kernels. This is why, for the same amount of time, the beginning of training, we actually have higher accuracy for the smaller network. However, we can also see that the red line, the red continuous line, is our validation accuracy, and we can also see that it actually is higher than the one obtained with the smaller network. And this is actually expected. As we said earlier, some higher frequencies in the image cannot be captured with smaller kernels. So basically, at the end, for training the entire network using 55 networks, the higher one, the bigger network with higher resolution, actually took 269.1 hours for training and achieved 59% of 25% of the accuracy, while the smaller one it trained in less than half of this training time, but it only achieved 55.55% of accuracy. So still we ask ourselves, can we use this smaller network, at least at the beginning, we train at the beginning with the smaller configuration and then upscale and continue training? Answer is yes, but there's this slight saturation problem, meaning that if I do this upscaling, if I start training my network with a small configuration, and I upscale just later on when my learning rate is already too small, then I have one saturation effect that you can see here. This graph, what it says is, that I start my network, and then at these points, I upscale it to the original target. I upscale here at the clock 17, 18, 19, 1, 28, and so on. And then I want to see what is my final accuracy, continuing a predetermined training schedule. So basically, we can see that if I start at early epochs, okay, I can get actually the same accuracy of the bigger network Okay, these the red the black lines, they are actually the thresholds for the bigger and the smaller metals. So while you see that the smaller ones, when we upscale the network at a later epoch, we don't even achieve